you do. Be invited in good places like Tel Aviv.
Great software.
Seriously, that's all you got?
Yeah.
You ready?
Do we want to get into that?
You can use DNA.
Boy, those robots have cool performance.
Hey everyone, I'm Gil, and I'm going to talk with you today a little bit about my experience, mostly from my current role, which has been basically the same role for the past 5.5 or 6 years. So a bit of background about myself, because it will be relevant, because it's usually interesting to know who's talking to you in order to understand where they're coming from. So I've been around the industry for the past 15 years or so. For the past five or six years, I've been running engineering at Ravello Systems, which is actually right now Oracle Ravello. We got acquired a few months ago. I'll talk a bit about that. And before that, spent quite some time at the IDF. I can see a few guys over there. Ooh. At the Intelligence Forces, doing all kinds of stuff, both as a developer and my last role is very relevant actually to this talk, because I was the CDO of one of the development branches and was in charge also a lot of on methodology and how should people walk. So Ravello, or Oracle Ravello right now, so for those of you who know us, and for those who don't, we've been founded in 2011, small startup. I joined very early days, like five guys, thinking, can we actually do something with the idea that we have? And we got acquired in 2016, like 6 months ago, so I guess we did something with the idea that we had. It's a service company, software as a service, which is very important to what I'm going to talk about. Most of the lessons here are relevant to software as a service companies. I think you can take some of the ideas also for on-prem or classic software delivery, or even to embedded to some extent, but the bulk of it is relevant to software as a service. As the entire industry shifts there, I guess it is relevant to most of you. A few words about Ravello. Ravello is basically a virtual cloud provider, meaning I guess most of you are familiar with AWS, GCP, Azure. So, and what we do in Ravello is that we are a virtual cloud provider, meaning we supply infrastructure running on top of those cloud providers, without owning any infrastructure. And the unique thing about the service that we created is that it allows you to take any workload, usually an environment running on-prem, on VMware, some setup, virtual machines, some network topology, some storage topology, take it all as is, do not change a single bit in it. The same images, the same IP addresses, MAC addresses, everything remains exactly the same. Just take it as is, run a clone of it on top of Ravello in the cloud. The reason I'm mentioning that is not because I want you guys to start using us. It would be great, but that's not the reason. Because that the technology stack for that is quite hefty. It goes all the way down to a hypervisor that we've developed. It's basically a nested hypervisor. I skip all the gory details. And all the way up to basically an internet backend which manages all of those. That's going to be very relevant to that. And last but not least, we're a pretty small organization. So 35 developers, single site, and I'll talk about the structure in a sec. Also important to understand who our customers are. So we're talking mostly about ISVs, like software vendors, which can be a bit more traditional in some cases, for example, McAfee or F5, and also some enterprises, which can be not that simple to deal with. So we're not talking about startups or new born in the cloud companies, so more the traditional type of companies. Okay, great, so I gave you a lot of introduction. Who am I and what's Ravello, et cetera, et cetera. And what we're actually going to talk about today is that most, if not all, software as a service companies have realized that they need to move fast as they can. This isn't new. People have been talking about continuous integration, continuous delivery for a very, very long time. I'm not going to explain why you need to deliver quickly. I'm guessing this is the baseline in the room. If not, you can go out, read a bit, Google, come back. Great, so we need to deliver quickly. This isn't new. The things that you need to do that in order to achieve that can differ greatly between different organizations. It depends on how much you're willing to break stuff, a la Facebook prior to 2013 when they changed from move fast and break stuff to move fast with good infrastructure or something like that, with stable infrastructure. And what's your current state? Do you currently have customers which would leave you if things would break? Did you sell them on some features in your future roadmap? Do you have obligations in terms of versioning, et cetera, et cetera? Or you're just starting out and you can build from scratch. What's the ad hoc processes and culture that you have? And the goal of this session right now is basically to share with you the things that worked for us, the things that we've identified as the key ingredients in order to make it a successful journey for your organizations. And the ingredients that I'm going to talk about today, and they're not listed in order of importance, are culture, tooling, process, structure, and leadership. As at least for us, those are the five key ingredients in order for such a transformation to actually work in an organization. And I'm going to talk on this from the entire organization point of view, because the engineer organization wants to deliver quickly, but in some cases the sales organization wants to be able to commit on a feature to some customer, and those can clash in some cases, so it's important to mention those. So first, and at least in my mind, the most important and tricky ingredient is culture. And it's tricky, that's the reason we have the pomegranate here, because it can be messy, for those of you who enjoy eating pomegranate once in a while, and it can leave you with a bitter taste. And it requires some guts to actually start messing with. But if you do that wisely, you can get, this is probably the most important part of any engineering organization or actually a tech company. I'm not talking about the values on the wall, those things that you would print on the wall, rather the real day-to-day behavior of the organization. For example, it's a good thing to look at, what are engineers measured on? Is that quality code, or is that, for example, value to the user, shipping to production, being nice to each other, not being assholes, teaching each other, documenting stuff? Is an engineer expected to spend his time building a feature or solving a bug? Working on infra or documenting? Obviously, it's a blend. It's not that an organization should do just a single thing. But the actual weights between those things are derived from the culture. And in order for you to have the right culture to be able to continuously deliver, the first thing that you need is a management buy-in. You cannot really do that, transform your organization, just doing that bottom-up from engineering. It's a great idea, you can try, you will likely to fail. This isn't a decision that can be completely contained inside your engineering organization. I can share with you that, for example, in our specific case, the first board of director meeting for Ravello Systems, you've got your Sequoias and All West and all those VCs. And the first thing that I actually presented to them was about continuous delivery. They probably couldn't care less at that stage. But we wanted to set the stage for them to understand that this is how we want to work, and it is going to have impact looking forward. What kind of impact would actually top management cares about? For example, transparency. Why? We'll go to that in a second, but you want your engineers to be able to understand what's going on in the organization and what's going on in the business. And you want them to be able to do that because you want them to really care, to be autonomous, to take decisions and be able to change stuff all the way to production without having too many barriers. And that's a top executive decision if you want to, for example, share all details with everyone in the company. You want them to be accountable for what they're doing. You want and will need to recruit top talent. Top talent is tricky to get to, expensive to get, and hard to retain. And everyone in the company's management is going to need to deal with that. All of those cannot work without management completely bought in. Another great example, deadlines. I don't know how many of you have interaction with a sales organization, for example, but in many, many cases, an account manager or sales engineer would push hard in order to get a deadline for a specific feature or a bug fix. And when do you commit to deadlines? To whom? For what purpose? And the key assumption in a continuously delivering organization is that you keep reprioritizing, having great engineers on board, and if you have these two, and those engineers have a thing for shipping fast, you're always working on the right thing and you're always advancing in the right direction. So what purpose does deadlines have here? Actually, at least we and a lot of similar other organizations are trying to avoid giving deadlines as much as possible, because usually they will actually slow you down. And this will be a constant clash between engineering and ops in some cases with sales. And you need the entire company's management to understand that this is the organization that we're trying to build, because we really believe in the values of continuously delivering organization. So there are some cases where you actually need to commit to a deadline. For example, if there is an external event, there's a conference, you want to have some kind of announcement, you need to commit to a deadline. In that case of a unicorn customer, the customer that will actually transform the company's future, you will need to commit to a deadline, but you need to understand that. For this, you need visibility. And it's also a management tool, and that's probably the most common case where you use it. It's also usually a sign that some engineer need to actually improve himself if he needs external deadlines in order to work better. Okay, so I guess we established that you need the right culture in order to be able to deliver quickly, and we'll touch on that in a sec. But we also need some additional ingredients. And the first one, the second one that I'm going to touch on is your structure. And I'm not going to give you a recipe for this is a structure which will work. Clans and tribes, flat organization, tree, arc, whatever. I'm going to give some traits. And the key thing to understand here is that we're building the structure to support the culture. Okay? Not the other way around. It's not that we have a structure and then we'll adapt the culture accordingly. But we have a culture. We want to ship fast. We want our developers to know that they're responsible for what they do, that they're accountable for it, that they have a key part of the business actually doing good. So now we need to build a structure for that. And a structure has some very strong ties to culture. For example, if we compare two organizations, one is very hierarchical, centralistic, compared to a flat distributed one, you probably know a lot about the culture and expectations from every single developer. For example, for a single developer, how many pit stops does he have to go through before actually releasing something? It's a process question, it's also a structure question. And the second reason is Conway's Law. You probably know, all of you know Conway's Law. For those who do not, Conway, back then, realized that there was a very strong relation and resemblance between the organizational structure and the system architecture. If you're going to have four different teams developing something, it is very likely that you're going to have four different components with some APIs between those. And inside each component, you might have a tangle of all kinds of stuff. The thing to understand here is that you can actually exploit Conway's Law to your benefit, because you can enforce a specific structure which would enforce a specific architecture which would be great from continuous delivery point of view. For example, for an organization to actually being able to continuously deliver is tough. It would be great if you would have decoupled and autonomous teams. If you're very small, just fall back to the flat organization, great. As you scale, it can be a bit harder, but you do want to be able to structure yourself such a way that every team, group, whatever name you want to call it, is decoupled and autonomous. And it's from the delivery process point of view, meaning from the minute that you start thinking of a feature until it is running in production. You want that as small as possible unit to be able to be as autonomous as possible, because you want to make the processes for them releasing as easy as possible. You want minimum handovers. And I'll touch on DevOps and QA, test automation in a second. Again, you don't want, ideally, you want zero handovers between the developer and production. And you don't want any additional gatekeepers. By the way, when we're talking about decoupled, autonomous, as small as possible, it probably ring a bell for all those microservices hyped people in the room. There is a question whether what's the result and what's leading to that, but there is a very strong relation between organizational structure, microservices, and continuous delivery, obviously. Some very common anti-patterns, and I'm guessing that many of you are doing something similar to those anti-patterns. The first one is the test automation team, which basically means that you took some of the responsibility, if you remember that slide, out of your autonomous dev team and gave it to someone else who's in charge of testing your developers, which are not responsible now, end to end. They cannot really deliver completely on their own. They need to talk with someone else. There's going to be a blaming game between them and them. And if you have a lot of different technologies in an organization like we do, most likely you're going to have the least common denominator in the infrastructure in order to test everyone, which is going to be a shitty infrastructure in order to test everyone. And you actually want the dev teams to be responsible for that. Very similar with DevOps, by the way. I'm not talking about let's rename IT to DevOps, but about the actual things that you need to do mostly around, well, development code and operations in order to ship your stuff. And you want it to be contained inside that same autonomous unit which actually ships stuff. QA team is a great question. There's a debate. Do we still need a QA team? There's the no QA movement. What will all those people do now? QA are terrified by continuous delivery because they used to be the gatekeeper. At least in our case, we shifted stuff. We don't have a classic, we used to have, by the way. We used to have all of those. We don't have a classic QA team. We have a test engineering team, but the role is completely different. They're not gatekeepers, and they're not responsible for quality, actually. What they're doing is helping the organization to walk in the right way from quality point of view. For example, helping the developers, which will eventually be in charge and responsible for the features, but helping them understand what kind of test they need to run, what's the test plan which is required for the feature that they're going to release. They're going to do exploratory testing. They're going to work together with support in order to understand what the users actually need in order to bring that feedback back inside the organization. But what's most important is they're not gatekeepers, and they're not in charge of quality, meaning they're not quality assurance team, right? Great. So we understood that you need the right structure. You're also going to need the right tooling. And again, the right tools will empower your developers and enable them basically in order to fulfill the culture, meaning to take responsibility and become accountable. That's the reason of the tooling. Also, you're going to have great developers. You want to be able for them to do everything on their own. They don't, great developers are lazy, you probably know that. So they're going to have great tooling in order for them to be, to do as less as possible. Some examples for tooling, and that's probably the bare minimum, and the importance of a specific tool can differ greatly between different organizations. For example, centralized logging. When you go to the wood and chop stuff, right? So centralized logging is very important to your team for visibility and monitoring. You want them to be able to own their stuff all the way from talking to product management until production. Give them the visibility to understand what the hell is actually going on in production. So they're going to need monitoring tools and they're going to have access to logs. You want them to be able to actually test and say that everything is working great from the minute that they commit a change until it is in production. It means they're going to need to have access to a lot of infrastructure. For example, for provisioning containers, VMs, whatever, depends on your organization, full environments, deploy your code, deploy the entire system, test it, configure it. There's a bulk of different tools that you actually need in order to be able to continuously deliver and do continuous integration. Just looking at testing, which at least, this is really the bare minimum. You need to be able to know that you introduced a change and it is working. And at least on the Ravello case, here there are different strategies, a lot of different strategies on what should you actually test and what's the cost of a bug going all the way to production. At least in our case, the sensitivity is very high for a bug, because in some cases it can introduce to our customers data loss, downtime. They're using us for mission critical, and we cannot really tolerate, they cannot really tolerate, so we cannot really tolerate such issues. Meaning the level of fidelity of the different tests that we need to run is very high. Now there are a lot of types of tests, that's a topic for a few different sessions, but we're not talking just about unit tests, which is usually, well, the developers in the room would obviously all agree that they need to unit test their stuff. If not, the door over there. So you need to unit test your stuff, but you also need to actually make sure that it works in system level. So integration system, upgrade tests, you're going to have a lot of data in your service. How do you make sure that when you deploy the next version, it's not really a version, the next drop to production, you're not breaking stuff from data integrity point of view. Performance testing, stress testing, so a lot of testing. And each and every one of those should be done inside each component, again, which is delivered by a specific team, which is autonomous, should be done continuously, because you have a lot of those teams and components and you want to make sure that everything works and keep them autonomous, meaning that they can always drop their stuff to production. Also know that this actually means no branching. So it means that everyone needs to always work on master, mainline, trunk, whatever system that you're using. It also means that you're going to need to have feature toggles, feature flags for every change that you do. And you want your test to be as high fidelity as possible. Meaning you want that the infrastructure that you're testing on should be as similar as possible to production. To remind you, we're still talking about tooling, so this has a lot of implications on tooling. We talked about provisioning and deployment and configuration. All of those are related to the fact that you want to actually test on something which is similar to production. Again, I'm talking about system tests right now, also performance stress, not about unit tests. It also has a lot of implications on backward and forward compatibility, because you're going to have a lot of different versions of different components which need to be able to actually interact with each other in production. And on feature toggles, the ability to actually introduce a code change without it affecting production in any way, and then introducing it into production once it is fully tested and you're feeling comfortable with it, usually in a gradual way, maybe also use it for an A-B test. So it means that if you take a look at the classic continuous integration pipeline, you basically have something like that, right? You build, obviously, and that depends on the type of programming language and technology that you use. Then you want to create or start an environment to actually test on. You set up it, you deploy code to it, you run it to system tests. For example, this is CI pipeline per component for system tests. You tear it down. The way we do it in Ravello is basically with Jenkins, which orchestrate everything, Ansible for setup, deploy. The actual system tests are different according to the component. It can be Selenium Protractor, etc. for the UI, TestNG for the backend, PyTest for the lower level stuff, which is in C and assembly, but we won't write tests in assembly. Not that crazy. And we're using, that's actually Ravello in a very poor resolution. So we're actually using Ravello in order to create those high fidelity environments. Because what you see here is part of our backend, basically, running on top of Ravello, a bit nested. So we're using Ravello in order to actually provision and deploy to an environment which is as similar as possible to production. You can also do it with other tools. It's very easy to do with Ravello, but again, I'm not here to sell to you guys. Okay, so we've covered culture, structure, and tools. We also need to have clear leadership. And this leadership needs to advocate and continuously explain and push the organization in order to maintain the culture. And probably the hardest thing for this leadership is to always understand if there are issues, and there are always issues, and change. Do organizational changes, devote the time in order to change the tooling, change the processes, bring new people on board. And this requires leadership, which has the traits and the values of continuous integration and continuous deployment in mind. And last but not least, but actually a little bit least, process is probably the least important part of the previous ingredients. It's the cherry on top. Process is important, but at least from my experience, I told you in the past, I was advocating for processes in some intelligence units. Oh, you should work like this, you should work like that. To tell you a secret, it's crap, it's bullshit. Eventually, if you have a good team with the right mentality, the right culture, that's the important stuff. Structure them correctly, give them the time to choose the right tools with the right leaders in place, the right processes will just emerge for you. At least for us, very lightweight, feature-centric, very lightweight. It can be an interesting talk on all the problems in Scrum. So very lightweight process, at least that's my recommendation, but the key ingredient here to understand is that the processes will just emerge. Don't try and force them over the organization. And I'm saying that as the VP of engineering, as the one who's in charge for processes. So some results, as I said, well, we've made a lot of progress since we started. We started, it was a hot big mess. A startup company wants to run as fast as possible in order to start bringing customers on board. The important stuff that you have to have in the beginning is the right culture, have the right leadership, and then everything else will follow. We're not in a perfect place right now, but we're in a good place. We're happy with where we are. Because what I just showed you right now is in everyone's engineering, operations, product, even sales, top management, day-to-day acts and thinking. We've adjusted here a lot as we've moved along in all aspects. And it's also very important to never fall in love with your own mistakes. Understand that you did a mistake. You created the wrong team. You chose the wrong tool. You tried to force the wrong process and back off. That's it. Thank you very much. I hope it was interesting. Thanks.